Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves, continuing medical education podcast. Join us for a lively discussion on the latest and greatest in the field of electrocardiography. We'll discuss some of the exciting and innovative work happening at Mayo Clinic and beyond with the most brilliant minds in the space and provide valuable insights that can be directly applied to your practice. Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves. In this episode, we focus on post-cardiac atrial arrhythmia ablation monitoring. Joining us is a cardiac electrophysiologist and expert in the space, here to provide insights on selecting the right monitoring approach. We're going to cover key aspects of ECG monitoring cardiac ablation afterwards, rhythm monitoring strategies amidst the various available technologies today, as well as the benefits and pitfalls of different monitoring methods. But first, let me introduce you to our guest. Dr. Suraj Kapa is no stranger to us. He's a board-certified cardiologist and cardiac electrophysiologist specializing in the management of complex arrhythmias. He completed medical school at the University of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey, followed by internal medicine training here at Mayo Clinic in Rochester and fellowships in cardiology and cardiac electrophysiology at the University of Pennsylvania. Dr. Kapa focuses on complex cardiac and epicardial ablations and is deeply involved in clinical research and the development of new technologies. He also leads several initiatives to enhance patient care delivery within Mayo Clinic's heart rhythm services, and he currently serves as a section editor for circulation, arrhythmia, and electrophysiology. Dr. Kapa, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
You know, so we've been really wanting to get you on for some time, and I'm really grateful for you to agree with this, but I think this is a big topic in this space, especially from patients. But in terms of post-cardiac ablation and care, when you think of the ECG and the monitoring component of that, what are things that are important to you from your standpoint that we should be really thinking about?
Yeah, so, you know, when we talk about cardiac ablation, I mean, most people, when they think of cardiac ablation, traditionally think of atrial fibrillation ablation. But really, with any cardiac ablation, the core goal of it really is to relieve or suppress the arrhythmia that's causing a patient to either feel symptomatic or to lead to other comorbid conditions that might affect their daily life or their longevity. And so ultimately, when we do an ablation, the goal is to get rid of that arrhythmia. And given that, the goal of ECGs or ECG monitoring technologies after such an ablation is really to guide us along really three areas. One is acutely after the procedure to make sure that everything looks okay, to make sure there's no evidence of, you know, injury to the tissue in such a way that would make us concerned of something else going on, depending on where we might have waited or what we might have targeted. Number two is trying to evaluate, were we successful or not? Were we able to adequately suppress what we were trying to target? And then number three, which frankly is as important as anything else, is a lot of things we do in cardiac ablation are targeted towards improving quality of life, because either a patient might present with episodic shortness of breath or a feeling of palpitations, or might be concerned that the arrhythmia might be causing an array of other symptoms. So sometimes post-ablation monitoring is meant to clarify, was the rhythm that we presume to have been causing your symptoms, if you're still having those symptoms, is it really the cause? And thus we try to further clarify whether or not there might be additional attributes that might be contributing to a given patient's symptoms by assessing that presence of that arrhythmia against a continued or potential continued presence of symptoms.
And so from a clinical standpoint, do you have those three things? And when you're thinking of more of like the monitoring side of things, I mean, there's such a plethora of different devices. And I feel like when I talk to you, there's always something new coming out and that you're always well, you know, ahead of everyone that even knows about these. But how do you really, you know, choose the best strategy? How do you navigate all the options out there to figure out what is the best approach for the patient?
So we really need to think about indication-based decision-making of what we're using to assess how a patient's doing. So, you know, let's use the example that we just mentioned of atrial fibrillation. So what do I really want to know about somebody's atrial fibrillation after they have an ablation? Number one, I want to be able to know, did it come back? Now, then the question becomes, how intensively do I need to monitor them? And what mechanism do I use to monitor them to evaluate for that recurrence? If you go back 5, 10, 15 years ago, that was often just an episodic Holter monitor. You might wear a monitor for 24 hours or 48 hours or sometimes even longer, and we would look for any presence of recurrence over that time period. However, the value of that might be limited. Say somebody's only having atrial fibrillation one day every 3 months. It's luck of the draw. But beyond that, what we think about is, well, should I do longer-term monitoring? Should I do a 30-day monitor? Now, that'll help me feel even better that your AFib is suppressed. But again, I go back to that patient who's one episode every 3 months. Is that really sufficient? So then I might get to what we call an implantable loop recorder, which is a device that we can physically implant. It goes under the skin that allows us for continuous monitoring up to 3 years. But to be honest, there are patients who can have atrial fibrillation recurrence 5 or 10 years after an ablation procedure. So then we talk about other approaches of patients monitoring themselves, such as checking their pulse on a twice daily basis and trying to identify whether there's an irregularity in the pulse. But then we get to newer technologies that allow patients to somewhat track themselves, such as the cardia monitor, which is a little device that allows us to put our fingers on it and generate an ECG on a smartphone, or such as the Apple Watch, which allows us to generate an ECG directly on the watch and allows us to better identify, okay, is this an episode of AFib that I was feeling? Is it not? Or even check it on a daily or twice daily or however many daily basis to clarify whether there's any evidence of recurrence. So the way we often will talk to a patient about it is it's in large part based on, okay, how do we look for recurrence? How intensively do we look for that recurrence? And then how much do we clarify that recurrence over the longer term?
Okay, and so when you think about that, it seems to vary based on the patient. What is your general approach? Would you say the most common approach have?
So this is kind of where we get to shared decision making in many cases, because when you have a plethora of different monitors and different approaches, and they all have, frankly, downsides and upsides, the question is what makes the best sense, whether in terms of how obtrusive they are for the patient, how costly they are from either patient or insurance perspective, how invasive they are in terms of, you know, having to cut into the skin or do things like that. So all of those are things we talk about with the patient in that context.
And so it seems like there's no, lack of supply of approaches or devices out there. Even now, this home recording monitoring, whether it's the cardia or even, Apple Watch devices. Where do you see the advantages? You could certainly see some of them, but where are also the downsides that you see maybe from both you as a clinician and maybe from the patient's perspective?
Yeah, so I mean, as you're correctly pointing out, there are unfortunately many downsides in all of these cases. You know, so if I talk about, as I said earlier, an episodic Holter monitor, say I say, okay, I'll just do a 24-hour Holter every few months. The problem with doing a 24-hour Holter every few months is that we can do it for sure, but do I really feel confident that that monitor that was done, just for 24 hours is reflective of the other 364 days of the year in terms of the lack of evidence of recurrence? Not necessarily, but it might give us some certainty. Now, in the case of an arrhythmia that was happening every day, X percentage of the day, and now I do a Holter and I see it's not happening that percentage of the day, that's a little bit more certain. That's a little bit more sufficient for what I need. Now, the problem with a Holter monitor or even some of the longer-term wearable monitors is they're adhesive. And many patients can actually be very sensitive to the adhesive from the devices. And that can actually result in limitations in compliance with their use and the ability of a patient to actually feel like, okay, I want to wear this every day or as often as possible for 30 days. So that's when we get to things like this implantable loop recorder, which sits under the skin. Now, obviously, it's more invasive. It's not sitting in the bloodstream. It can actually be done in most cases in the outpatient setting. But it's still a foreign body sitting in your body. And there's a risk of infection. There's a risk of bleeding in that area. And in many cases, it can be costly for patients. A lot of times, insurance might actually force the patient to pay for the monitoring fees, for their remote check fees of those devices. However, it gives a longer amount of certainty around whether or not there's any arrhythmia recurrences, a certain comfort level of being continuously monitored. And then we get to, you know, at-home, patient-driven devices like, as you mentioned, the Apple Watch, these cardiac monitors and whatnot. Now, obviously, these are very nice in the sense that they allow the patient to engage with their own health. However, they do have a high rate of false positives. You know, these devices, when they tell you you're in a normal rhythm, you can pretty reliably say you're probably in a normal rhythm. But to be quite honest, when they say you're possibly in an arrhythmia of some sort, they're often incorrect. So you see, you need some oversight on those outputs. That's kind of one big thing. And the other big thing is that it does require engagement between you and the device. They're episodic. There's not really much in terms of at-home, real-time, continuous monitoring that accords you every moment of every day. So it does require an engagement of the user with the device at some juncture. So that requires maybe some amount of technical savviness or ability to engage with their own technologies. So a lot of times it'll depend not just on who the user is and their comfort level with what you're talking to them about doing, but also what you're trying to identify. Now, for example, and this may not be specific to cardiac ablation monitoring, but when we talk about post-stroke monitoring, I'm looking for asymptomatic arrhythmias that might only happen episodically. I have no sense of how often they might be happening at all. In those cases, a patient-activated monitor doesn't offer me any benefit. I need a full, continuous monitor that doesn't actually leave out any information. In which case, something like a loop recorder, a continuous wearable monitor, makes a lot more sense.
And it's what it seems like is the clinical indication makes a difference. Oh, the monitoring approaches, certainly a lot of advantages, and then potential downsides, both from the patient end, from your end, the potential clinical burden of false positives that can come up, but a lot of options here. And what I think it comes down to, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it's really that shared decision-making of the patient's clinical case and why you're doing what you're doing for this, for them.
Precisely. And I think that's really what it gets down to, because not all cardiac ablation is the same, and not all of what we try to monitor relevant to that cardiac ablation is the same either. You know, it depends on characteristics of what the rhythm is, what the frequency of that rhythm is, what aspect of the impact of that arrhythmia on your quality of life is having and why we care about it, and then how do we look for it if we still think it's relevant to look for.
In today's episode, we explore the role of ECG monitoring in post-ablation care for atrial arrhythmias. Dr. Kapa gave us insights into what to look for on post-ablation ECGs, those three different things, and how to navigate rhythm monitoring options with patients. And there's so many out there, but it's clear that they all have benefits and potential pitfalls of them. And it really comes down to a shared decision making. Dr. Kapa, thank you so much for joining us, sharing your expertise, and offering us a way to navigate all the available and ever-growing rhythm monitoring options out there. We look forward to having you back. Thank you once again.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining us today. We invite you to share your thoughts and suggestions about the podcast at cveducation.mayo.edu. Be sure to subscribe to a Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular CME podcast on your favorite platform. And tune in every other week to explore today's most pressing electrocardiography topics with your colleagues at Mayo Clinic.
This has been a Mayo Clinic podcast.